Et bien, c'est quand même pour Wright.
Buongiorno. Allora, che bello essere qui di nuovo e che bello raccontarvi chi è, intervistare quest'uomo, questo giovane uomo che è accanto a me, che si chiama Omar Mohammed. Ve lo racconto in pochissimo tempo perché credo che la cosa più importante per tutti noi sia ascoltare quello che lui ha da raccontarci. Il 7 giugno del 2014, Mosul, la seconda città dell'Iraq, viene conquistata dall'ISIS. 1300 guerriglieri dell'ISIS, armatissimi, entrano in città e conquistano una città che era la seconda città più grande, è la seconda città più grande dell'Iraq, 2 milioni di abitanti, più di Milano. Alcuni salutano i combattenti dell'ISIS come dei liberatori, altri cercano di fuggire, altri vengono immediatamente uccisi. L'esercito iracheno è in rotta, alcuni si consegnano al nemico, alcuni fuggono, alcuni hanno già tradito da tempo. Resta il fatto che nessuno in quel momento realizza esattamente quello che sta accadendo. Realizzerà soltanto poco tempo dopo, poche settimane dopo, che Mosul si è trasformata nella più grande prigione a cielo aperto del mondo, in un luogo di violenze inaudite. E 7 giugno, conquista di Mosul. 29 di giugno, proclamazione dello Stato Islamico. Le immagini le avete viste tutte. Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi sale nella moschea più importante di Mosul, la moschea di al-Nuri, e proclama la nascita dello Stato Islamico. Mosul è la città simbolo dello Stato Islamico insieme a Raqqa, la più importante, la più grande. Arriviamo a luglio del 2017, quando Mosul verrà liberata, e dalla liberazione di Mosul comincerà, diciamo, la sconfitta autentica dello Stato Islamico alla quale stiamo adesso assistendo. Ma torniamo a quel giugno del 2014. L'ISIS stabilisce la sede dello Stato Islamico dentro quella città e comincia una repressione spaventosa. Dentro quella città, tra tante persone spaventate, tra tante persone che tradiscono, tra tante persone che subiscono questa terribile dittatura, c'è un giovane uomo che allora ha 28 anni, storico, laureato in storia all'Università di Mosul, che si nasconde dentro la sua casa e poi comincia a vivere la vita di Mosul. Ma non è appunto un cittadino normale, è una specie di archivio vivente, archivio storico vivente di quell'esperienza. È una specie di scatola nera che servirà a raccontarci cosa è stata la tragedia dell'ISIS durante quel periodo. Quell'uomo molto coraggioso, molto, molto spericolato, quell'uomo che ha mille cose da raccontarci, che ha vissuto mille avventure e mille pericoli, e probabilmente i pericoli li corre ancora, è quest'uomo qui, è Omar Mohammed. Tutto questo lo fa con un blog, usando i mezzi che sono possibili, che ci descriverà, un blog che si chiama Mosul Eye, l'unica luce, l'unica fonte di informazione per un lungo periodo di quello che sta succedendo dentro quella prigione, dentro quell'esperimento mostruoso che è stato ed è lo Stato Islamico. Allora, ovviamente per me è molto emozionante intervistarlo. E io sono stato a Mosul nel marzo del 2017, quando, nel pieno della battaglia per la riconquista di quella città, e quindi ho toccato con mano che cosa è stata quella battaglia, le tragedie che sono state vissute. Però io vorrei cominciare dall'inizio, da quel 7 di giugno. Omar, com'è stato possibile che poco più di 1000 combattenti conquistassero una città così grande e così importante? Che cosa è successo davvero?
Well,
First, thank you, Corrado, for this introduction, and thanks for the International Journalism Festival for inviting me, and thanks for all the people who are attending to listen to me in such a beautiful city. You are all reminding me of my people, and this city reminds me of my destroyed city, the city that was destroyed by the so-called Islamic State that brought the death, the disaster to one of the most ancient cities in the world, that is Mosul. It's quite difficult to talk about how everything happened. It's also quite difficult to repeat what I have witnessed, what I have lived. I have repeated this many times as I am living, still living with this. Still remember what I have witnessed, still remember the eyes of the executed people, or the eyes of the children, of the crying mothers. You ask me about how this happened. It's also still a question for me. I'm still asking this question to myself. But 6th of June wasn't the beginning of the collapse of the 60,000 soldiers who left the city in front of 300 ISIS fighters. On 6th of June, everything was ready to collapse, as ISIS have been working in the city since 2005. I remember in 2005, we were able to see and to read on the walls things like the Islamic State of Iraq and Sham, referring to the Levant, which is Syria. And to go back to 2003, since 2003, everything was changed. We started to see on daily basis fights between the Americans and the terrorists, public executions. I still remember in 2000, it was April 2004, the terrorist burned a soldier alive in front of a religious building, and the people were looking at, it's quite funny, but it's difficult. We're looking at the man who was burning, but they were able to go to practice their religion. Then we started to witness the bomb cars. They were able to develop their bombs, starting from a small piece of bombs to create the bomb cars. In the beginning, they were killing like two or three, but after 2005, they were able to kill more than 100 at once. In 2005, something happened in Mosul. At that time, it was called the police station's offensive. It was an offensive led by multi-terrorist groups attacking the police stations in the city. Most of these fighters at that time weren't from Mosul, from the outskirts of the city, from the rural areas, and many Arab jihadists. So in 2005, they led this offensive against the police stations. The police administration was new, was just recently established after the US government dismissed and canceled all the old system in Iraq. They bombed at the same time 15 bomb car in Mosul. About 500 person was killed. None of the policemen was attacked. All of them were civilians. I'm sorry of telling such things I witnessed, but I have to say it. At that time, it was May 2005, I found in my uncle's house a piece of part of one of the victim's head. I was able to see hands. I wasn't able to identify whose hand is this. After 2005, these kind of attacks increased, but it wasn't only terrorism. It was also the corruption among the government. The people became at that time stuck between the corruption of the government and the terrorism. So if I get threats from the terrorist, I can't report it to the police, because if I do so, the terrorist will easily find my name and they will come to kill me. And many people were killed. Starting from 2008, I'm saying this, and the Americans were still in the city. But the terrorism was able to grow up because the government or whoever was in control of the city was closing their eyes on this growing terrorism. After 2008, the terrorism became more organized. And they started from that time collecting money from the people, but also controlling most of the economy in the city. Not only the economy related to the civilians, but also that is related to the government. So no one is able to build a school without going through them or to pay their share. 2011 was the biggest mistake of the United States when they decided to leave. After 2011, terrorism became or took control of the whole city. So from 2011 to 2013, Mosul was already in the hands of ISIS, but they were still working underground. The corruption became more effective in the city. ISIS was taking money from the people. The police were taking, and the security forces were taking money from the people. So the city was already done. Then came June 2014. It was 3 a.m. It was Friday. I remember at that time I was inside my room working on preparing an exam for my students. It was the first exam to my students. But it never happened. They never read the questions. I heard some voices, people calling for, or shouting, or calling like, Viva la Islamic State, Viva Islamic State. And they started fighting. Because they started, or they began their offensive from my neighborhood. I am living in the northwest of Mosul, where they came from that side. They started the fight from 3 a.m. By 11 a.m., the whole west bank of the city was in their hands. Reports estimate that in the west part of the city of Mosul was at least 30,000 Iraq soldiers, police, army, special forces, etc. But it's not the fight that led them to collapse. It's all that process since 2003 to 2014. The logical result was to get ISIS.
Insomma, il terreno è stato preparato a lungo. C'è stata una lunga preparazione all'arrivo dei terroristi. Qual è stato l'atteggiamento della popolazione nelle prime settimane in cui è arrivata l'ISIS? Questa è la prima cosa che vorrei che ci spiegassi. Se all'inizio sono stati accolti in qualche maniera comunque come dei liberatori, dei moralizzatori che avrebbero in qualche maniera corretto le storture, le angherie che erano state compiute dal governo centrale di Baghdad. E la seconda cosa che ti voglio chiedere è che tu vorrei che tu ci descrivessi rapidamente come è cambiata la vita quotidiana tua e di voi abitanti di Mosul sotto l'ISIS. Che cosa è cambiato fondamentalmente? Come si svolgeva la vostra vita? Qual era il problema principale?
Well, to answer the first question, which is a very complicated question, because there is a huge misunderstanding about the early days of ISIS. Did the people welcome and support ISIS or not? As a citizen of Mosul myself, and I witnessed this, I can safely say the people didn't welcome ISIS. The people welcomed the situation. The free Iraqi government city, no more a soldier in the street. I remember in 2011, I was just coming back from Egypt. I was studying at the American University in Cairo. So I was young, someone is happy going to the university. In the street, there was a checkpoint. You can't use your phone while you are driving, not because they care about you, but for security issues. So I was about 20 meters away from the checkpoint, and my mother was talking to me by phone because there was a bump car close to my house, and she was checking, did I survive or not? This was 2011. So talking in the phone, some of the soldiers, I don't know how he found out that I am using the phone. All of a sudden, I found myself getting out of the window. They even didn't open the door of the car, and they started hitting me. That's why I say the people didn't welcome ISIS. The people welcomed the situation without such things. I was quite nice to them, and I didn't do anything bad. But for many people, those who have probably no education, those who were poor, it will be easily for them to join ISIS or to support ISIS or to support this kind of activities. But this was only for a few weeks, this kind of what I call the honeymoon, the people who thought that this is a new situation, things are going to change, and also not to mention the propaganda of the former governor of the city, who appeared in the public at the night, at the third night of the attack, and he said, don't worry, was addressing the people of Mosul, don't worry, these are our brothers, took the power from the corrupted government, and they will hand over the power to the right people. And also, something most important to mention here, which I didn't notice in many international media, they never talked about this. The Turkish consulate and the whole staff didn't leave the city. So as a citizen, if I see a diplomat staying in the city, why should I leave? Why shouldn't I stay? This was the situation. It was so complicated, and the people were misled and were confused. But after August 2014, when ISIS started, or let me say, when ISIS began its systematic destruction of the city, when they started with the Christian, deported the Christian, and issued what they call it like the deportation of Christian, and also what happened, the genocide against the Yazidis. From that time, everyone in the city was able to recognize what is ISIS, but it was too late to recognize this. It was too late to leave the city because there was also a huge misunderstanding between the other Iraqis and the people of Mosul. We were accused by our own people that we supported ISIS. So we were left again with no options. I can't go to Baghdad, because I am both Sunni, considered as Sunni, and considered as ISIS supporter. And I can't go to Kurdistan, because it was a war zone between Mosul and Kurdistan. So we had nothing to do, we had no options. but staying in the city.
Allora, credo che sia importante raccontare come nasce il tuo blog, il tuo racconto dall'interno dello Stato Islamico. Tanti di noi, tra l'altro, si chiedono come fosse possibile comunicare con l'esterno. Per esempio, il sistema dei telefoni, di internet, funzionava? Veniva sorvegliato? Come facevi a far uscire informazioni? Ed è vero che ti sei mimetizzato, ti sei finto un fanatico islamista per riuscire a stare vicino a loro e farti raccontare le cose? Ci puoi spiegare come hai iniziato a fare questa attività, che era un'attività pericolosissima, perché sappiamo che chiunque fosse stato trovato in possesso di un filmato sul telefonino sarebbe stato ucciso immediatamente, no? Allora, le domande sono: con che strumento hai fatto questo blog e come facevi a comunicare all'esterno? Come funzionava internet? Che tipo di sorveglianza c'era su internet da parte delle pattuglie dello Stato Islamico? E se ci racconti questo tuo sistema di infiltrazione, diciamo, di mimetizzazione per ottenere le informazioni.
Well, it was dangerous, but it was also funny. From the night of the attack, I started using my personal account. Probably I was stupid to use my personal account because I didn't recognize the danger yet. Because this attack, well, a week before the attack of ISIS, there was another attack. They took control of the city for about 24 hours. Then the security forces took back the city. The first thing I did, started writing what I witnessed at the first night, saying who are they, because I was more interested to understand who are they. I saw new cars, new weapons, people were well organized. But the third day of the attack, it was, I came to conclusion that if I keep doing this on my personal account with my name, my picture on the account, it will be dangerous because I realized that this is going to last long. It's quite different from what I have witnessed before. So here, Mosul, I came. Working in this condition of anonymity, blogging only what I see. Because if you are a historian and you want to write the truth, you have to witness what you are writing about. You have to be as much as you can objective. So I started Mosul Eye writing about the daily life, but I chose to write in English because ISIS was a global issue. And also ISIS had a huge propaganda machine. The fourth day of ISIS existence in Mosul, I was able to see that they established all their administrations. I saw their posters. They had something like media outlets, big screens in the street. I was asking how could they prepare all of this? Because what we were reading in the news, they said ISIS came to take revenge of one of their leaders who was killed 2 days before the attack. But this was a joke. These people were well prepared. They brought all their administrations. They opened the police stations. They applied what they call the Islamic law, and they distributed something called the Constitution of the city, using an early Islamic term referring to the constitution that was built between the Prophet of Islam and the non-Muslim and Muslim in the city of Medina in Saudi Arabia. So looking at all of these things, these people are well aware of what they are doing. It's not a joke. It's not something that will end after we wake up. It's not even a nightmare. It's something well established well organized, with their new cars and with the different nationalities. The first one I remember, I was able to communicate with him. He was a Chinese American. He was eating bread. I wanted to know, what's he doing here? Why he's here? Then I was shocked. He said, this is the duty of Islam. I said, you are coming from China. What do you know about Islam? Then I witnessed, or I saw many other nationalities, Asians, Europeans, Americans, Africans. The city of Mosul became, I mean, this is not the globality we wanted to see in Mosul. Well, we want to be connected to the world, but not through terrorism. we wanted Mosul to be a place where someone think about going as a tourist, not as a terrorist. So I realized how dangerous is this and how this is going to change the history of Mosul. Because, believe me, death was the easiest thing in Mosul. ISIS came to change the history, and in what they call it, the constitution of the city. In the last article, it's a document of 16 articles. It's kind of a law. In the last article, they were saying, you have experienced all the regimes. You have experienced secularism, the republic, you have experienced the colonialism, everything. Now it's the time to experience the caliphate. And under this title comes the death and the change of the history. So I felt obliged, not just for the current moment, I felt obliged that I have to protect the future of the city. Because I know, as a historian, that after many years, people will come and will start ask what happened in Mosul. If I didn't write the history at this moment, they will only have the narrative of ISIS. And no one can blame them to believe ISIS because there is only one narrative. So putting this in mind, in my mind, taking the risk, and I knew from that time what the price would be, what price should I pay, and started doing this on a daily basis.
So you pretended to be religious, faceva finta di essere molto religioso. Did you pretend to be religious? Faceva finta di essere uno molto religioso per avere le confidenze di quelli dell'ISIS?
Well, not just religious, I pretended to be working in a bakery, I worked in a grocery, I even pretended to be a doctor, but I never treated any patient. I also worked as a taxi driver. I had to do this because I needed more information. I mean, after many months, several months in Mosul, ISIS became more like offensive. They were more monitoring the daily life, watching everything happening, questioning everything, suspecting everything. So going to, because they were religious, I needed this mind of a religious person. And because I can claim that I know, I have a good knowledge of history and religion. So in order to talk to them, to communicate to them, I had to find something, a reason for them to talk to me. So one of the funniest moments in Mosul was, and how I used this religious phase. I remember in the old city of Mosul was walking with my mother. My mother didn't wear the niqab, because in Islam, women older than 50 years and girls under 10 years are not obliged to wear niqab. So one of what they call the hisba is the Islamic police, he stopped me and my mother. He said, why you are not wearing the
niqab?
Yeah. Then I looked at him, I told him, what are you saying? He He said, "Why she is not wearing? I have to give you like paper. Then you should visit the Islamic police." I told him, "Stop! Wait! What are you saying? Are you sure?" He said, "Yes." I told him, "Shame on you! Are you sure you are a soldier in the Islamic State?" He said, "Yes." "Why you are asking me?" I told him, "Because you are really a shame on the Islamic State. Where is your leader?" And my mother was saying, "Omar, what are you doing? Stop it! You are going to kill us." I told him, "Mom, just wait. I know what I am doing." Then I told him, "Don't you know that the Prophet said women older than 50 years are not obliged to?" He said, "No, I didn't know. I'm sorry." Then he thought that I am a leader in the Islamic State. And he said, "Please don't report me."
And what, tell me, what about the internet? How did you use internet? Was there any control on the use of internet? C'era un controllo su internet? Come facevi a usarlo?
The internet until the beginning of 2015 was still normal. But then the internet connection and the cell phone connection was shut down by the government. But ISIS brought its own internet network because they were This is connected to the economy of ISIS, how they were getting money. They brought this kind of networks from Syria to sell it in the city, $3,000 for each. So the companies, the internet providers, took this from ISIS and they provided internet. ISIS had its reason to keep internet working in the city because they wanted to keep control and watching the people. So after the beginning of 2015, to get internet, there is an application. You have to fill out this application. You give your name, your address, your identity card, and also your password of your email or any social media account. If I'm going to do this, they will easily find me. So I had to, in a very dangerous conditions, I had to take the risk to talk to one of my friends. He was working in an internet company to fill out a fake application, and he did. And this is how I kept getting internet access. But it was so dangerous because at any moment they could ask him. But then I started to forget about the fear. As I told you in the beginning, death and the fear became, believe me, became the easiest thing in the city. Many people already wanted to die. I did. But feeling responsible and feeling like the voice of 3 million silent person living in such a huge prison, and even inside your home, in your bed, you don't feel safe. So this responsibility made me continue this and to take the risk. Sometimes the internet was also shut down by ISIS. So to get connection, there was a possibility to go to a bit out of the city using the phone to get the cell phone connection. So my brother was coming with me. I told him, why don't you come with me to help me? He didn't know. My family didn't know about anything. So going with my brother, used my brother. My brother died in Mosul. I hope he can hear me to tell him thank you for what he has done to help me. So going out of the city, hiding the phone while he's driving, reporting, posting something on Mosul Eye, and delete everything from the mobile phone, okay, and come back.
Omar, questa è una domanda, insomma, complicata, perché so che tu hai su questo una sensibilità molto, molto forte, però credo che si debba capire meglio questo dell'ISIS. C'è una grande differenza tra L'ISIS e il nazismo, che il nazismo, diciamo, ha compiuto degli atti atroci, ma li nascondeva, non voleva che venissero conosciuti, mentre invece l'ISIS fa della propaganda, del mostrare le atrocità, le violenze, gli eccidi, le torture, un punto proprio forte, per cui ci sono questi filmati che mostrano nei minimi dettagli le atrocità. Ecco, quello che ti voglio chiedere è dove arriva la propaganda, dove finisce la propaganda e dove comincia la realtà? Cioè, tutto quello che in Occidente abbiamo visto nei filmati di propaganda dell'ISIS corrisponde esattamente al vero? So che tu non vuoi, me lo hai chiesto e mi sembra una richiesta molto giusta e molto civile, non vuoi addentrarti nelle violenze terribili a cui hai assistito, ma ci puoi dire qual è la differenza tra la propaganda e la realtà?
I mean, a simple example of this propaganda, it was 22nd of April 2015. They brought two men who were wearing this kind of orange uniform for execution. They brought them to the street in a place called Babatop in the west bank of Mosul. This was the execution square of ISIS. People were around these two men, but not civilians, ISIS people, ISIS fighters. The first look at this scene, you think yourself, there is a film producer producing a film for Hollywood. This is not a real execution. Three cameramen standing in different positions, starting before their position to know from which angle they are going to record. Taking their time while the victims are waiting to be executed. I was there by accident because I always go to the market, this old market of Mosul. One of the ISIS fighters, he was the cameraman, the second cameraman. He was asking the other fighter, do you think should I shoot the video from this angle while he cut his head or from that angle? Imagine what they are discussing. Then he laughed and he told him, we can put the camera in the three dimensions so we can see how the blood get out of his neck. And the victims were listening to this. The executor, who had a sword, was looking at the cameraman, telling them, did you take your position? Are you ready? We should work. Imagining this moment, I mean, I tried to convince myself that this is not real. But it was so real. It was even beyond reality. They beheaded them. After the beheading, he was reviewing his video. He asked me, was the video good? This is what ISIS did in Mosul. This is how ISIS
La propaganda e la realtà erano la stessa cosa, questo è il punto. La violenza era indirizzata alla propaganda, non esisteva violenza senza che questa diventasse immediatamente un video di propaganda che doveva essere recapitato in Occidente e mostrato a tutti noi. Credo che questa violenza spaventosa a cui tu hai assistito ti abbia a un certo punto poi spinto a prendere una decisione, no? Quella di lasciare Mosul. Tu hai documentato, hai raccontato con questi rischi enormi per la tua sicurezza e per la sicurezza della tua famiglia, hai raccontato tutto questo sul blog Mosul Eye. Però a un certo punto vai da tua madre una mattina e gli dici: mamma, io vado. Perché? E che cosa è successo poi?
The fact is that before I decided to leave Mosul in late of 2015, I decided to, in March 2015, I decided to simply die. I can't kill myself because this is not my attitude. But there was a possibility to get killed by ISIS. I went to a place that I love, which is the river of Tigris in the old city of Mosul. Not the old city, sorry, but on the shore of the river. Shaved my beard, wearing like jeans and red. Smoking publicly, listening to music, and having what I called it like tea party, the last tea party, the final, waiting for ISIS to come to
take you.
Yeah, because at that moment I was done. I mean, I was so tired of seeing what is happening in the city, not for just for the first time. Witnessing this, then going back to Mosul Eye to document it, to publish it, then at the night, remembering everything, hearing the voices of the victims, the blood was killing me. I could smell their blood. So I decided to die, but I didn't. That's why I'm here. But at the end of 2015, I don't know why I didn't want to die at that time. I thought like I still have to do more. But most importantly, I wanted to protect my family, because in case ISIS would find me in Mosul, it's not only me who will be killed. I've been protecting my family, doing this to protect my family. I don't want to be the reason for my family to be killed. So I forced myself to leave. Actually, I forced myself to leave. To take the risk, or to at least I would accept to be killed out of Mosul. They will not have any piece of paper to identify me. But I managed to go to the safety, but I didn't stop. Then I decided to continue my work, to continue Mosul Eye, to continue writing the history of Mosul, to protect the future of Mosul, and to talk on behalf of the 3 million victims who were still in the prison. I was lucky to flee, but many people were still in the city, living in the fear, living in the state of fear. At that time, I was based in Turkey, but from the middle of 2016, after I spent some time in Turkey, Mosul Eye somehow changed, because the battle was getting closer. And they started the battle then later. Mosul Eye became at this time not only publishing what's happening in the city, at this time was through my sources, through my family, through my relatives, but also from inside ISIS. I created a very complicated network, relatives of ISIS through them to inside ISIS, etc. But when the battle began, Mosul, I became more about how to do something to help the people during the battle. So what happened is, and this was really, shocking for me, but it was so important to understand more about Mosul Eye. I received a message through the Facebook page, Mosul Eye, from someone telling me, it was late of 2016. He told me, I am writing to you from Australia. I am from Iraq, but based in Australia. And I was left with no options, and you are the last attempt that I have, because I have heard that Mosul Eye is the main page on, the main source on Mosul. I told him, what can I do for you? He said, my niece and her children are trapped in their house because her husband was killed by an airstrike. So I asked him, what can I do for you? He said, can you help rescuing him, them? I told him, what can I do? I am in Turkey and I have no connections with security forces. But then I realized, like, probably I can do something, because communication is so important at this point. So I asked him to give me some more information. He gave me her phone. I talked to her by phone. At that time, I used Skype, subscribing to Skype to make international calls without exposing my number. So I talked to her. She was a doctor, Dr. Sarah, asking her to keep calm and to not go out because it's not safe. And from the information I got from her and geolocating her house, I contacted some of my contacts, asking them, well, to be honest, he told me that she was born in the United States. So I said, like, this is a good reason to help her. So I wrote to the CENTCOM, which is the Central Command. I told them, one of your citizens are trapped. I'm not sure you want ISIS to have this citizen. They said, no, of course not. So they sent the information to the forces on the ground, and they rescued her. And then she was moved to Erbil, another one of Iraq, and I talked to her, and she was safe. From that thing that happened, this kind of mission, I thought, like, I can grow this up. And from that time, Mosul Eye became a platform to rescue people, the trapped people, because the air strikes, well, the people were getting killed by ISIS, by the air strikes, by everything. So people started sending information about their families, asking for help. And I had, like, through one of the journalists, contact in the international coalition, also to the security forces. When I receive, the first thing I do is to make sure that this is not a trap from ISIS. So I need the phone number, also to make sure they are civilians, not ISIS, and to geolocate them. I am quite proud of this, that I was able, through this communication, to help in saving 92 families. My family was one of them, because my family also was trapped. So from that time, Mosul Eye became more about how to make Mosul possible to go through this battle, because the battle was really destructive. So Mosul Eye became more as a platform for the people of Mosul, but also a window for the globe to get into Mosul, and to make Mosul more able to communicate, to take all the possibilities to help in whatever I can. So it became like a huge network in the city.
Allora, scusate, io sapete che per quanto mi riguarda non esiste un argomento più appassionante e importante di questo al mondo, in questo momento almeno per quanto riguarda le mie passioni giornalistiche, quindi io rimarrei qui 3 giorni, lo sequestrerei Omar per chiedergli tutte le cose possibili, però credo che avremo circa 10 minuti ancora, quindi ti chiederei, avrei 2 o 3 domande ancora da farti, vediamo se riusciamo a soddisfare ancora qualche curiosità. La prima è questa: io sono arrivato a Mosul nel marzo del 2017, come vi dicevo, e c'era una battaglia che infuriava, io sono rimasto sconvolto anche in quel caso, e poi successivamente lo stesso mi è capitato quando sono stato a Raqqa, dal livello incredibile di distruzione che ho visto di Mosul. Cioè Mosul era una città in alcune parti assolutamente cancellata, e a Mosul in particolare mi ricordo di avere proprio assistito a moltissimi airstrikes, a moltissimi attacchi dall'alto con gli elicotteri in particolare che bombardavano il centro della città. Poche settimane dopo che noi siamo andati via da Mosul, il minareto di Al-Nuri, il minareto storto, la torre di Pisa dell'Islam, un monumento straordinario, è stato poi distrutto, no? Ecco, allora io la domanda che ti faccio è, tu sei uno storico, quindi è importante ricostruire poi anche i numeri, no, di questa tragedia. Siamo riusciti a capire quanti civili sono rimasti, quanti civili inermi, innocenti sono rimasti sotto le macerie di Mosul? Se era necessario per sconfiggere l'ISIS bombardare con quella violenza le case, secondo te era l'unico modo per debellare l'ISIS? E di conseguenza tu pensi che l'ISIS sia davvero stata debellata, nel senso, o pensi che tra i profughi e coloro che sono scappati da Mosul ci siano anche molti combattenti dell'ISIS che si sono mimetizzati tra loro?
Well, about the destruction of the city and the battle and the air strikes and why this and the number of the victims. The government says about 3,000 only were killed, which is not true. The estimated number of the civilians who were killed just between October 2016 and October 2016 and July 2017, about 40,000 civilians were killed just during the battle. And between 2014, when ISIS came, to the beginning of the battle, about 9,000 were killed. So we have about 50,000 civilians were killed in Mosul 2014, 2017. This is for the civilians. According to the UN numbers, about 80% of the west part of the city of Mosul was completely demolished to ground. Nothing left. When you take a look about at the battle itself, the east part of the city wasn't that damaged. And somehow the battle was, or they say it was, easier. But when it comes to the west part, and to be honest, what happened in west part of Mosul reminds me of what happened in Berlin after the Second World War. I don't want to mention this, but this is like someone wanted to punish the city of Mosul because they think that as the Islamic State was established here, this city should be punished, so no other city will think again to do the same. But the victims were the civilians. But also, to be honest here, we also lost about 13,000 soldiers, those who sacrificed themselves to liberate the city, but at a very high price. I can't say they had many options, but they didn't use these options. I don't know why. I hope that someone would tell me why my city was destroyed. but I don't know that anyone from those who fought in the city of Mosul dare to tell me why. Because the reason is quite, it's difficult for them to justify what they did.
Diciamo che non siamo andati per il sottile, a un certo punto si è usato tutto l'armamentario, i bombardamenti dall'alto per sconfiggere l'ISIS. D'altro canto però Omar invece in un periodo precedente io ho l'impressione che non si sia fatto abbastanza da parte per esempio dell'Occidente per sconfiggere e fermare l'ISIS e ti chiedo un tuo parere su questo. La Highway 47, la statale 47, la principale arteria di comunicazione tra Mosul e la Siria, attraverso la quale passavano le armi, i soldati, le merci dello Stato islamico tra Raqqa e Mosul, è rimasta intatta per molto tempo. Per molto tempo si è permesso all'ISIS di spostarsi lungo questa strada senza che gli americani e i curdi potessero fermare questo traffico. Ecco, non hai la sensazione che per un periodo, in fondo, a molti paesi, a molte potenze regionali, per esempio, penso ai sauditi, ai turchi, facesse comodo che l'ISIS esistesse?
I don't know if it was good for them. I don't want to get trouble in with some countries, but many of the, I mean, Turkey, for an example, about 25,000 foreign fighters came through their borders. And until the middle of 2015, the oil or the petrol cars of ISIS were freely moving between Mosul and Raqqa. ISIS was easily moving between, not only between Mosul and Raqqa, but ISIS in Mosul was living in, everything was obvious. You can target them at any moment, but no one did. While a very long convoy of petrol cars moving from Mosul to Raqqa, it wasn't possible for the aircraft or the air forces to witness them, but they were able to witness or to geolocate a small car of civilians fleeing from Mosul to Turkey. They were able to see this car, but they couldn't identify if they were civilian or not. And they airstriked this, but they weren't able to see these cars. And this is also related to how ISIS came. A month before the attack, there were some reports saying that there are groups of fighters preparing to attack Mosul from Syria, which is ISIS. And some of them are already based in Mosul. These were kind of intelligence reports. But no one did anything to prevent this from happening. So Mosul in somehow was sold out to ISIS or someone, I'm sure there is no connection with ISIS and other governments. It's not kind of argument that I support. But in somehow, some people closed their eyes on ISIS. And I saw how ISIS worked in Mosul. They waited for ISIS to create everything. Why should you wait? They were able to take over ISIS in the first few months. But they didn't. They were waiting for ISIS to expand. They were waiting for ISIS to control everything, to commit these genocides against the Yazidis and against the Christian. About 6,000 Sunni people, ISIS climbing, they are here to protect the Sunni people, protecting them from who? They killed 6,000 Sunni persone in Mosul.
Ho un'ultima domanda per... Concordo moltissimo con l'analisi di Omar. Ho un'ultima domanda perché davvero dobbiamo chiudere. Sempre mentre ero a Mosul, a un certo punto mi sono fuori da Mosul, in un campo profughi mi sono imbattuto in delle donne che ormai erano andate via da Mosul ed erano in una zona sicura di Mosul, ma continuavano ad essere coperte e avere soltanto gli occhi fuori con il niqab. E quando io gli ho chiesto perché continuavano a tenere il velo, loro mi rispondevano perché abbiamo paura che l'ISIS torni, quindi avevano paura a scoprirsi. Allora l'ultima domanda che ti faccio è: c'è il rischio che l'ISIS torni di nuovo? E quanto è difficile per la gente di Mosul, ma anche secondo te per la gente di Raqqa, per tutti coloro che sono stati sotto questa atroce dittatura, riabituarsi alla libertà?
It's quite simple to answer such a question because if they repeat the same mistakes, it will not only just ISIS, it will be a very developed version of ISIS. The consequences of what happened in 2014, 2017 are really huge. And what's happening now in the aftermath, it's a very critical moment. If the Iraqi government, especially the Iraqi government, and the international coalition, the international community, if they repeat the same mistakes of 2003 to 2014, we will have more versions of ISIS. And to tell you, you mentioned this example of this woman who was afraid of taking off the niqab. Believe me, people in Mosul are still afraid, not just only of ISIS, they are still afraid of everything. They are not safe. ISIS is still there. They have just arrested some of ISIS fighters recently, and they are still arresting, while also innocent people are arrested, but ISIS fighters are released. I have reports that many of ISIS fighters made it to Turkey, and some of them even in Central Asia, in many other countries. How could they go?
Io ringrazio moltissimo Omar Mohammed, grazie per il tuo straordinario racconto, ma soprattutto grazie per il tuo coraggio, per averci fatto conoscere dal di dentro quello che è successo. Grazie davvero.